For the next session, we will have the talk show session with the 1 hour time from the Australian government by Siap Siaga with the topic presentation and panel discussion on the synthesis report of the Indo-Pacific Regional Learning on COVID-19 and its impact on disaster risk management and resilience. For the speakers, this stage is yours.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. We're back. Today, I will be waiting from some of the speakers on the way. But while waiting, I'm going to talk to you about this. I mean, if you haven't got this book report, I will have it on our booth. It's very interesting because this is like the result of almost a year learning journey, getting from different organization, different time frame, different models of collecting experience. We got the regional webinar, we got the symposium. Closer. Okay. Can I open? Much better. Negative. Both tests, 3 times shut, proven. So, let me get the book again, let me start. Because resilience is local, is a result of 1 year journey. We started with a discussion internally, and then we have regional discussion with regional actors. Then we have the symposium to validate whether this is just a talk or we have evidence about it. And then we start to consolidate all the regional talk, all the regional report, all the regional thinking into the report. And the conclusion is very interesting. Resilience is a local thing. Because resilience is local, because it is. Resilience is local. That's the whole conclusion. I mean, if you couldn't have a time to hear all of this, couldn't have a time to read all of what is inside the report, just remember one thing. When we talk about resilient, we talk about local for a very simple reason. And the reason is simple, because resilient is local. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. I've been waiting for that clap for 5 minutes. So whoever started, thank you. Next time when I try to ignite my voice, it is a sign, give me a clap. Thank you very much. Now let us start the show. Do we have the speakers in the house already? Good. Now what we're going to do for today, we have time to until 14:30. Of course, even though we have a Sistama in the house, time cannot be extended. Let us first welcome to the stage Pa Sistama of BNPB. Pa Lili, can please join us on the stage, and also Her Excellency the Ambassador of Australia to Indonesia. Please join us on the stage. Please, Pa. Please. Big round of applause. They're talking in Bahasa Indonesia. Ambassador, that's very impressive. Excellency, I think the audience is very impressed with your ability Bahasa. I mean, I'm Indonesian. That's a different level of Bahasa. Very native. Then we have Arshinta. Thank you so much for joining. From Yakum, Yogyakarta, and then we have Nia from Plan International Thailand, and of course we have Pak Noto here, the team of Siap Siaga. Lucy, the team leader, Lucy in the house. Lucy, thank you so much. Can you join us? Now, if you see all this report, you know, there's a part of a team, there's someone always leading the team, and that would be Oliver. Oliver, thank you so much for joining us. Thank you so much for pushing the agenda with one single mission, because resilient is local. Thank you so much. Now I'm going to go back to the stage. We'll go to the order. Pak Lili, we would like to hear a few words from you untuk berbagi, untuk opening remark, untuk arahan.
Baik, terima kasih Pak Said Faisal. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakuh. Selamat.
Bapak mau berdiri barangkali, Pak.
Oh, saya berdiri aja.
Okay. Biar kelihatan the sestama of BNPB, ladies and gentlemen. Big round of applause.
Ya, baik. Terima kasih Pak Said Faisal. Saya ingin mengantarkan saja sebenarnya dari diskusi sore hari ini, yang saya hormati Bu Duta Besar, Bapak Ibu sekalian yang mungkin tidak bisa saya sebut satu persatu, dan tentu saja kawan-kawan penggerak pengurangan risiko bencana, pelaku pejuang kemanusiaan yang hari ini hadir. Saya mohon maaf, saya bicara dengan bahasa Indonesia supaya lebih mudah saja. Saya ingin menunjukkan saja ke kita semua, sejalan dengan tema kita pada sore hari ini. Resiliensi adalah lokal, seperti yang tema yang kita bicarakan.
Topiknya belum ya? Untuk ininya?
Kita tahu Indonesia dan banyak negara di dunia ini memiliki risiko bencana yang mungkin hampir sama. Kita mengenal ada tsunami, ada gempa bumi, ada bencana yang terkait dengan iklim, dan sekarang kita sama-sama mengalami pandemi COVID-19. Tentu pandemi COVID-19 ini mengajarkan banyak hal bagi Indonesia dan dunia yang terkait dengan bagaimana kita memulihkan diri, bagaimana kita bekerja sama. Dan semua orang ini memiliki peran, memiliki tanggung jawab yang sama. Tidak mungkin hanya satu saja, pemerintah saja. Begitu juga dengan bicara dengan bencana. Bencana itu melanda daerah-daerah lokal. Ya. Jadi yang terkena bencana itu bukan sesuatu yang harus di kota, tetapi bisa juga di desa-desa, di tempat-tempat yang tidak siap kita menerima bencana itu. Nah, bagaimana kemudian strategi yang kita harus lakukan? Tentu saja kita harus memperkuat semua yang ada di kapasitas lokal yang ada. Kita harus yakin bumi kita satu, ya. Saya ingin meng-highlight lagi, bumi kita satu, kita hidup dalam bumi yang sama. Tentu semua negara harus bekerja sama, saling mendukung satu dengan yang lain. Dan apa yang kita lakukan hari ini tentu menjadi warisan dari generasi kita berikutnya. Kita ingin anak kita, cucu kita, generasi mendatang juga dapat menikmati apa yang dihasilkan atau ada di bumi ini. Kita tidak boleh merusaknya. Ini harus kita lakukan, dan satu hal yang penting, kita tidak bisa melakukan ini hanya proyek saja. Ini harus satu gerakan yang kita bangun bersama. Rumah resiliensi yang hari ini digagas oleh Indonesia, menjadi rumah resiliensi Indonesia, menjadi bagian yang tidak terpisahkan dari agenda besar GPDRR 2022. Ini adalah sarana membangun diskusi, membangun, implementasi, kita saling berbagi pengetahuan, berbagi pengalaman kita dalam menangani bencana, tentu dengan harapan pada satu titik pembelajaran yang baik ini, walaupun itu dilakukan di Indonesia, di Australia, di Yogyakarta, di Thailand, dan di tempat-tempat lain, kita ambil, kita gunakan untuk melakukan upaya-upaya pengurangan risiko bencana. Yang ujungnya adalah pembangunan berkelanjutan, yang kemudian harus memperkuat kapasitas lokal agar menjadi resilient. Kita hidup berdampingan dengan ancaman bencana. Kita berdampingan dengan risiko bencana. Tetapi juga kita berdampingan dengan ancaman perubahan iklim yang mau tidak mau sudah ada di dekat kita. Nah, kini harus kita antisipasi dan kita perkuat semuanya. Tugas pemerintah adalah memfasilitasi, menyiapkan sarana-prasarana, meningkatkan kapasitas yang ada di daerah, baik pemerintah daerah maupun semua pihak yang terkait. Di Indonesia kita mengenal pentahelix. Ada pemerintahnya, ada lembaga usaha, ada media massa, ada para ahli, para pakar, expert, ada masyarakat yang demikian banyak untuk melakukan upaya-upaya pengurangan risiko bencana. Satu klik lagi. Nah, saya ingin menyampaikan di dalam forum yang luar biasa ini, kita adalah relawan. Jadi, semua orang adalah relawan sebenarnya. Karena semua orang ini harus memiliki yang namanya jiwa kemanusiaan. Kita tidak bisa melakukan sendiri. Kita mempunyai satu bumi, kita hidup berdampingan satu dengan yang lain. Kita harus bekerja sama satu dengan yang lain. Tidak bisa kemudian kita hanya, yang penting kita bisa hidup, yang lain mungkin tidak hidup. Kita tidak bisa begitu. Saya mengajak rekan-rekan dari negara-negara yang lain, Indonesia siap bekerja sama dengan siapapun untuk masalah kemanusiaan. Karena kita ingin kita semua yang tinggal di daerah yang rawan bencana ini dapat selamat, dapat hidup harmonis berdampingan dengan bencana. Siapapun kita, tidak peduli status sosial kita, tidak peduli kita pejabat atau tidak, kita harus relawan. Saya tahu Bu Duta Besar punya waktu kerja jam 8 mungkin sampai dengan jam 5 sore. Tetapi ada bencana di jam 8 malam, nggak mungkin Bu Duta Besar kemudian diam saja. Pasti akan eager untuk membantu. Itulah relawan yang ada di Ibu Duta Besar. Dan saya ingin mengucapkan apresiasi pada beliau dan teman-teman semua yang hadir menempatkan waktu untuk bicara mengenai resiliensi. Tetapi tidak cukup kita hanya bicara di sini. Setelah ini kita harus melakukan aksi. Lakukanlah aksi sekecil apapun di tempat Anda berada. Lakukan itu karena kita tahu bencana tidak hanya bisa didiskusikan, diseminarkan, tetapi harus kita lakukan aksi yang kita bisa lakukan sesuai dengan kapasitas kita. Demikian mungkin sebagai awal dari diskusi kita. Terima kasih Pak Said Faisal sudah mengundang saya di sini dan para narasumber semuanya dan Bapak Ibu sekalian. Mari kita bincangkan resiliensi es lokal. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum.
Thank you. Terima kasih Pak Lili sudah hadir di acara kami. Thank you so much Pak Lili. As one important thing that being shared by Pak Lili, our Sestama of BNPB, we live in the same planet, it's a planet Earth, and we live together in that planet. And that is a very strong reason for all of us to collaborate in reducing risk for our planet. One more time, big round of applause to Pak Lili, our Sestama, and now we're welcoming the ambassador of Australia to Indonesia, Excellency Penny William. Please, madam.
Big round of applause. ingin menyampaikan ucapan selamat atas penyelenggaraan acara Global Platform on Disaster Risk Reduction serta Rumah Resiliensi Indonesia yang mengesankan. Sungguh merupakan tugas yang sulit saat kita masih berada di tengah berbagai ketidakpastian karena COVID-19. Congratulations. I'm really delighted to be here in the Rumah Resiliensi today to see so many good examples of the impressive disaster risk management efforts in Indonesia. Australia has been very proud to partner with Indonesia over many years on this important challenge and, as Pak said, shared challenge. I'm so pleased that we have such a large delegation here from Australia, together with representatives of the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade and the National Recovery and Resilience Agency. Today's event is the culmination of a year-long learning journey that Australia and Indonesia have led together. This journey examined the impact of COVID-19 and its impact has had on disaster risk management in the Indo-Pacific region. It's a manifestation of the strength of the Australia-Indonesia Partnership on Disaster Risk Management, or SIAPA program. It also highlights the partnership's focus on knowledge and learning to improve regional humanitarian action and disaster management. I am so delighted to share the podium today with Dr. Pak Lilik and would like to acknowledge his steadfast leadership throughout this process. I'd also like to recognise the role played by the Indonesian Ministry of Foreign Affairs, through whom we were actually able to showcase the learning process at the October 2021 Regional Conference on Humanitarian Assistance. As you'll hear this afternoon, this rigorous knowledge gathering exercise has led to the publication of a synthesis report entitled Because Resilience is Local. This report contains a number of important conclusions, especially around the need for disaster managers to routinely respect local knowledge and culture and to engage with local leadership, very importantly, on equal terms. The COVID-19 pandemic has brought new importance to these conclusions. The exercise also reminds us that the work of resilience is done predominantly by local communities, locally developed, locally held, and locally used. This learning process confirmed this so clearly that the discussion around resilience became the central focus of this synthesis report. And of course, the theme of DPPR this week has also resonated around the theme of resilience. So for Australia, this is certainly not the end of the learning journey. Perhaps it's better to describe this report as the beginning of that journey. The report presents the facts. It outlines the risks and the risk reduction and mitigation measures we can take. It urges national, regional and international actors to completely rethink their approach to disaster management. It encourages us to think holistically, to listen, to learn and to adapt so that the services we provide to the people affected by disasters and crises are aligned with what is actually needed in those communities. This also helps us ensure that the way in which those services are delivered enhances local level resilience. We sincerely hope that this report will contribute to a greater regional discourse on disaster management and resilience. One that can begin today and continue at the Asia Pacific Ministerial Conference on Disaster Risk Reduction, which Australia will host in Brisbane in September this year. I look forward to the next steps in this learning process. I look forward to continuing to work so closely with Indonesia. And once again, I'd like to thank my Indonesian colleagues for giving us this time and space to work out what these steps are going to be. On behalf of the Government of Australia, I commend this report to every one of you here today and congratulate those who've contributed so much to its success. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Ambassador Australia to Indonesia, Ms. Penny William, thank you so much. Very interesting, but this is not the end of the journey, but this is the beginning of a bigger journey. And
ensure that resilience is local, to ensure that when we do the program on resilience, we encourage ourselves to work with the local leaders at the E4 term. Thank you so much. Now, thanks to the agenda group by team leader, our team leader, Ibu Lucy, to present the report to both. Please stand both. And I want to take a picture with both. So that and the photographer in the house.
Thank you very much, Pak Sahid. I've been given the impossible task of explaining a little bit about the report, but not too much, because we want you to actually grab the reports and read them. So, but the report's actually selling up very fast, like you know. So, I would encourage everyone to just download it from our website. It's available in both languages, Indonesia and English. Since Madam Ambassador and Pak Lilis have already highlighted several findings in the report, so I'll just proceed with the presentation. I'll just proceed with the learning journey of the development of this report. Which began about a year and a half ago, and it was intentionally devised in anticipation for this event, GPDRR. The report was initially we were trying to investigate what are the impact of the pandemic towards the disaster management and disaster resilience. That was the initial thought. So we did our initial thought by trying to capture what people are thinking about the impact of pandemic toward disaster management and disaster resilience. There are a lot of people involved in this exercise. It was a regional exercise. We did a series of workshops. I see a number of prominent figures here. I think Jamila is here. We have Bu Arsita. We have some of the speaker here as well. We were involved in this process, and we tried to ask some question about how it impact resilience, how it impact disaster management at the local level, how it impact the architecture of disaster management at the global, regional, and the national level. How does it impact on news, media, the use of technology, which is quite obvious in terms of the uptake of technology during the pandemic. So that was the first series, and then we come up with three groups of thematic issues, so to speak. One is on the governance and institutional leadership, and then the second was on partnership models, which is also heavily discussed, and the third was again on the digital technology. So we convene a regional symposium. We open it out there, ask people to submit their paper, a call for paper open for everyone, and then people start submitting their paper. And then we selected some of this paper to be presented and discussed during the regional symposium. That happened actually in October last year. And then after that regional symposium, we tried to write a synthesis report, which is now available, and all of you can download or try to get a copy if there's still some left. And the recommendations is basically on two issues. Yes. First is about how we can better support localizations. That's the first issue. I mean, it's nothing new. We've been talking about localization since what? The Green Card in 2015. I mean, Jamila, you're involved. I mean, Masahid, Oliver. I mean, a lot of people here are involved in this, and it's pushing for localization. So it's nothing new. So why is it not happening? What does it take for it to move forward and to accelerate the uptake of localization? We have some analysis, we have some factors that support localization, and we have some factors that would accelerate localization, especially after our experience in pandemic, all covered in my notes. And then the second thing is, the second recommendation is about greater focus on resilience, particularly at the local level. And this is how we come up with a new dimension or a new variables when we are trying to analyze resilience. When we talk about resilience, and when you look at the definition of resilience, I mean, we look at the UN definitions or international organization definitions, it's mostly like talking on process, system and processes, and this report come up with the recommendations that basically suggest we need to also look at social and cultural capital. Why? Because resilience matter the most when it is actually at the local level. And human being, I mean, we argue that human being and communities is actually, I mean, resilience is an inherent trait of human being and communities. So why don't we build on that, use the social capital and use the cultural capital that's already available there, instead of putting some new system, putting something new that damage the inherent trait of resilience. In detail, of course, you would have to read the report. The report again is available. You can download it and grab a copy if it's still available out there. I would encourage you. And then, of course, there are some contacts as well. We welcome any questions and further discussions. Back to you, Pak Said. Thank you very much.
Thank you. A round of applause for Pak Noto, one of the members of our team. Together, we developed this, and fantastic contribution as well in the development. Thank you for summarizing this, Pak Noto. Now, before I move to our speakers today, I would like to introduce as well people that have been involved in this process, in this journey, from the webinar to the symposium. I think we'd like to welcome as well and introduce you to Jamila Mahmud and Adelina Kamal. Thank you so much for joining us, and thank you so much for being part of our learning journey. I will ask you as well about your input later during the discussion if you have some thoughts. Thank you so much. Now back to the stage. I'm going to ask the permission of Lucy. I'm going to turn to you. Now, let's start with a piece. Sorry. Thank you. difficult not to see the face. So sorry for people that I'm giving my back. That's even better suggestion. No, I don't need to sorry anyone. Look, I'm going to start with you. Tell us a little bit about your organization, and I'm going to ask you same question, and then we go to something. What's it? Your name, your role, your organization.
Thank you, Pak Said. Thank you, everyone, for having me. I am Arsinda from Yakum. Yakum is a local organization working for public health, and we are mostly working in Indonesia, but with our network, we also serving some countries in the region of Southeast Asia. The goal of our organization this process of voting is actually submitting our, not only a research, but actually a process of journey, because we are involving not only the policy makers, not only the professionals in the hospitals and the health institution, but most importantly, the marginalized group, people from transgender associations, people from disabled people associations, as well as women and elderly. And it actually gives us a relief feeling that everyone can speak with, everyone can be told, and we are supportive and proposing a very honest elaboration about the process of responding to COVID. That's number one. And number two is actually...
Can I keep the number two for my next question? Please. I'm going to come back to you and have this very interesting story, but tell us a little bit about your organization and then we will start to go deeper.
Thank you, Pak Said. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Yuchi. I'm currently working for my international disability regional office. My role is to cover the portfolio of school safety and resilience building within the regions. So we already had a very interesting but also meaningful time to work closely with Pak Said, Uniho, and Samsaya in this a year-long journey of learning, and not only joining with the development of the articles together with our colleagues in Sinta and Yakum and others, but it was also a chance for us to exchange our understanding and knowledge, as well as to highlight the mandates that we are promoting in terms of a right-based approach, so the feminist principles between disaster risks and disaster risk reduction and resilience building in multi-risk settings. That's one of our expectation. I'll take the second one later.
Thank you. Now I'll come back to you, Arsinda. You've been to this process in the very beginning, and also you wrote the what we call the research article, not even articles, like several pages, and we had a discussion. Now we got this because resilience is local report. Your impression after reading this report, what is in your mind when you look at this report?
Actually, it likes finding ourselves, because the findings and the conclusions, even the becoming the title of this report, that resilience is local, is actually confirming our very genuine belief that resilience is indeed inherited in our traits. Because I've been working in disaster management like 20 years, and I totally believe, trust, because seeing that disaster affected populations from Aceh to Papua, from very rural areas until the urban communities, they have been struggled, but also fighting the disaster impact themselves, and it seems like the resilience is already in their DNA. So the report is actually really confirming such kind of conclusions, but also actually finding ourselves after such momentous historical pandemic like this, and we have to come back to ourselves, believe in our resources, our capacity, and move forward with such confirming and fresh understanding that this field is really in our DNA.
That's very interesting. Before I go to Mia, you, from your explanation, I can feel the importance of local resilience, the importance of building the resilience from the local level and then move to national, understanding that the national resilience is the result of local resilience and international resilience is the result of national resilience.
But apart from that, any other thing that you can see that perhaps being ignored when we develop any program and being you know, addressing the resilient, but there's some principle of building local resilient from your point of view, it's not being really been touched. Anything on that?
Yeah, this was a very good question, Pak Said, because actually that's point existing in the recommendations. Guys, you have to read the recommendation because it's very concrete, it's very action-oriented and easy to follow. And one thing responding to Pak Said's question is because we see how people affected by pandemic, they have contributed whatever they have. People in transgender group, because they are stigmatized and they didn't have a shelter to. People just contribute, public contributing. But the problem is we put it under the partnership model, right? Okay. How people, especially the persons or the authority with resources, always think, oh, you have to come with offer proposal. You have to. No, it should be a journey together, a collaborative and consultative process, and understanding that everyone can contribute. I think that's the most essential part, and it is kind of like an opposite way or an opposite collaborations from the fact, the most challenge that this report mentioning about the working in silo. So it's kind of very dilemmatic and very kind of tragical that people are very contributive, people are really like to contribute, but also in the same time, we as the actors, the system is still working in silo. So I believe some ways we have to find a solution and compromise, and the recommendation provided are very, very action oriented.
Thank you. So I just want to conclude that even though we have a strong intention to collaborate, we understand the importance of collaboration, but somehow the system that being designed is not very encouraging for us to work together. There is invisible hand of building the silos so difficult to work with different organizations. I thank you, Shkandarinia, your views, your observation, your thought about the report.
Thank you, Pak Said. I think my first impression is that's an excellent initiative. And the report says it all because resilience is local. Before I continue, may I just ask our guest audience here, can any one of you say or tell us any words that you heard from Abele and our ambassadors who already mentioned in their speech? What are the two words that you heard a lot from their speeches? Anyone can? We have some small gift here. It's from our project's implementation in Indonesia. It's free for you to take, but any one of you want to, please come. Great to have you. What are the words that you heard from the speeches?
We live in one world. We live in one world. One world.
We live in one world.
Okay. One world. I hope everyone could hear that.
Welcome, residents.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you. So, thank you very much.
I just want to warn, if you answer the next question.
We still have more.
Magic's book, okay?
But more. Actually, those are the ones that I wanted to highlight. Thank you. Because our ladies here, you already mentioned the local resilience. And definitely, what I already wanted to share is there is a paradox that we need to avoid, which means that if you wanted to have like a one-size-fits-all strategy that apply to everyone, I don't think that it will be an effective way, right? So the report that our colleagues Pak Said, Oliva, and colleagues from CF Jagera already put together, it mentioned a lot about the findings that our colleagues, together with our year-long journey of investigation and the development of the recommendation, we found out that We cannot go that way with a one-size-fits-all. We have to have a central
thinking way, but the result should be local. And to make it happen, we should start with thinking globally, but act locally. And with that, thanks to this report, you have a lot of recommendation in there, and that led to our impression that a lot of the principles, a lot of the points about thinking globally and act locally have been shared widely. For us, as Plan International, we already promoted on the engagement of children and youth. And you know that disaster impact individuals differently. So we cannot have like the same things applying for children. We have to have another approach to work with children and youth, especially the young girls. We need to listen to them, hear their expectations, and let them talk, let them share with us their expectations, and then bring them forward into our discussion to make them obvious, seeing and seen and heard, so that they can share and learn from them. And that would help them to take more action to become the agent of change in the process of disaster resolution. One last point, sorry, Pak Said. It's also talking about our colleagues over there. You made it right. So locally, but also inclusive local disaster resilience. Because when we talk about like Pak Asinta already mentioned, when you talk about disaster, it should also be inclusiveness in there, because if we are excluding someone, that means the local people, the local communities will somehow be neglected with those vulnerable groups. And thank you so much for highlighting that point in your articles, and that's what makes us very proud to be part of this journey with Siap Siaga and the programs. Thank you very much.
I find it interesting that Kia mentioned about one size fits all approach. I think this is the contrast. Resilience is local, is about tailor-made approach for different contexts. I mean, to visualize this, why one size fits all approach is a bit problematic. Imagine if this, you know, everyone receive a free hair dryer, then I will be a bit problematic with that gift. It doesn't fit me, but that's what we usually do. We got a problem, everyone has hair, then give hair dryer, that must be useful. But not for me, what am I gonna do with that? But well, I better mention it. Thank you for joining us. Anyone else? Oh, okay. But we have been a minority here. If there is a give about hair dryer, that's a bit problematic. But that is how we design a program, a solution. One solution, give it to all. My question to two of you, what happened in the field when we have that solution? Start with you first. Any challenge in the field when you're being pushed, this is a solution, of course, being pushed by a bit of money behind incentive. This is a solution, give it to all.
What would it?
Yeah, actually, that's a really good question, Spasa, because at the time, different local stakeholders in Yogyakarta Congress responding to the pandemic, everyone has their capacity, everyone has the idea that this is the priorities that we should do to respond to the pandemic. But if the solutions, for instance, at the time that everyone has to to put the data for government that they have been infected or not, but we do not, if we didn't do go into details and ask the challenges where this particular group doesn't submit their data, where this particular group didn't go for vaccinations, we didn't know the challenges. But because we didn't go that way, we asked people, I mean, not only our organization, but very good collaborative approaches for various stakeholders. We went for more detailed data, not only about names and addresses, not only that, but also the needs to access the vaccine, to access the aid packages, as well as any basic needs that are not addressed at that time.
And I think if people are pushed to have only one solution, very differently people will be left behind.
So this tendency of pushing one solution and then expected everyone will comply with that solution or even will solve the problem of all those involved. And the reality, that is not the reality in the field. Yeah, your observation on one size fits all. What's the problem with that?
Yeah, thanks. Said, that leads me back again to the report. So, the report, sorry, not the report, but also the process that we have been involved in, it started during the process, during the period of COVID-19, right? So, during the COVID-19, we cannot act the same in different communities. And because in different communities, they have been, they were impacted, they were affected differently. And it reminds me of one of our youth, because we are working with youth and young ones a lot. So Greta Thunberg from Stockholm, from Sweden, she already had a request to everyone that let's act like you are in a firing house. But if we are in the same firing house, then we can act similarly. However, we are in different houses, so we need to have different evacuation plans. And those evacuation plans need to be local. It need to be fit with those houses specifically. Otherwise, we will go right to the wrong way, and we caught by the fire. So, but again, yeah, it is definitely a local resilience process, and we cannot have the same things applied for everyone. And I would want to emphasize this because it has been explicitly mentioned in the report. We work together centrally for the local results, and that will be the effective ways of our working forward for resilience building together.
Thank you. Now, I'll go to the audience. We have heard about the discussion a little bit, explanation from speakers today. Very interesting, what we call insight. Because apparently somehow there's a challenge as well in localization. And that challenge being addressed of providing a common solution to everyone. Now, I'm going to open the floor, whether you have questions, whether you have a thought on the discussion. At the same time, Ibu Jamila, Ibu Adlina, and also Oliver, I'm going to ask you views as well. If while waiting from others to raise hand, you want to start, Ibu Jamila. I know you can always start with anything. And then I'll start with you. Anything that you want to give, your observation.
Terima kasih Pak. Jadi laporan ini sangat penting dan berguna. Saya amat tertarik bahwa resiliensi itu dilihat dari segi lokal dan ini selalu disebut. Tapi di dalam laporan ini menunjukkan cara-cara praktik yang boleh digunakan. Untuk saya yang paling penting kita lihat apa punca daripada risiko yang kita alami dan seperti dikatakan oleh Bapak ini puncanya ialah kerana kita tidak menjaga bumi dan kita sebagai manusia ada peranan yang penting untuk bertindak dengan cara yang lebih bertanggungjawab kerana kita tidak harus terus hidup begini dan hanya cuba memperbaiki bila ada binasa dan
Terima kasih. You were involved in this process. You also wrote the research as part of the symposium.
Bahasa Indonesia atau bahasa Inggris?
Bahasa apa saja boleh.
Saja ya.
Boleh. Okay. Kalau bahasa aja nggak ada yang tahu nanti. Cuma saya dan beberapa orang.
Salah satu alasan saya datang itu karena saya ingin memberikan support kepada yang menulis buku ini. Kan nggak ada yang tahu nih siapa yang menulis buku ini. Who wrote this book? Three Handsome Gentlemen. Namanya Pak Said Faisal, Pak Oliver Lacey Hall, and Pak Kanjeng Notonegoro. Applause dong. Nah, this gentleman are very apa ya low profile, but congratulations, itu salah satu alasan saya datang ke sini. Tapi ada yang lebih hebat lagi dari teman-teman bertiga, yaitu Ibu Lucy. Tangan dong Ibu Lucy.
I just want to make sure that I'm the MC for today.
Tapi satu hal, tadi malam saya sama Ibu Jemilah berbicara di salah satu forum besar event mengenai peran perempuan untuk melakukan transformasi terhadap keterlanjutan and the future of SDG, disaster risk reduction dan planetary health. Ibu Jemilah memberikan alasan-alasan kenapa planetary health itu penting bagi kita semua, termasuk untuk Indonesia. Saya sendiri juga memberikan alasan-alasan apa yang bisa Indonesia dapatkan menjadi host di PDRR. Tidak hanya kan Indonesia adalah supermarket of disaster, tapi Indonesia bisa memberikan model resilience yang tidak ada di tempat lain. Jadi yang namanya resiliensi tidak harus, maaf, Jepang memang oke banget, makanya namanya Yokohama, Hyogo Framework for Action, Sendai Framework. Tapi kapan deh kita bisa punya namanya Bali Resilience Plan misalkan? BNPB bisa dong, orang apa namanya sumbernya inspirasi resiliensi ada kok di Indonesia. Nah, jadi terima kasih sekali lagi Ibu Lucy. Ibu Lucy yang paling hebat dari yang tulis sih, karena Ibu Lucy buku ini bisa kejadian. Ya, tapi saya juga berterima kasih. Satu hal yang mungkin harus diangkat adalah peran perempuan. Ya, bukan kenapa Pak? Karena half of the humanity actually are women, and we need to actually get the women to further promote the resilience.
Thank you. Terima kasih Ibu Adelina. Thank you so much. I have one raised hand, please.
Halo, selamat siang. Semoga semuanya sehat selalu. Perkenalkan, nama saya Berlian atau Uli Ibu Jani. Panggilan isyarat itu bagaimana sepertinya? Saya dari Palu, Provinsi Sulawesi Tengah. Sekarang saya mau bertanya tentang, oh ya, saya sudah baca laporan. Laporan tentang apa? Laporan tentang perlokalan itu, ketangguhan itu perlokalan. Laporannya itu bagus, sangat bagus, tapi saya tidak melihat ada inklusivitas dalamnya. Ya, jadi sekarang saya mau saran, memberikan masukan. Pertama tentang apa? Saya termasuk kelompok disabilitas, saya tuli. Saya punya hambatan pendengaran, tapi saya punya kemampuan. Saya punya kemampuan seperti orang-orang pada umumnya. Jadi saya minta tolong stop sebut kami sebagai orang-orang disabilitas yang tidak bisa apa-apa. Kemudian kedua, kami di Sulawesi Tengah sudah ada buat program. Programnya itu melibatkan kelompok disabilitas. Nama programnya apa? Programnya program pionir. Kerjasamanya dari mana? Dari ASB. Nah, di dalam program itu kami kelompok disabilitas, kami ditingkatkan kapasitasnya. Kami bisa jadi aktor lokal. Kami diberikan pendanaan untuk menjalankan program dan kami diberikan kesempatan yang sama. Terima kasih.
Terima kasih, tepuk tangan luar biasa sekali. Terima kasih sekali. Nanti kita kejam. Siapa lagi yang ada? Anyone want to give any? Okay, please.
you so much. So, actually, I have a question. So, I'm from the CFC on the program and been shadowing Oliver and Batnoto and yourself through this entire process. And what has been very evident to me is that when we talk about resilience being local, we really can't focus specifically on targets, but just talk about the people. And so my question for anybody on the panel or in the audience, does that mean that we need to rethink fundamentally how we do development? Our development is so target focused, and we look at numbers, we look at policies, but we don't look at the people that are actually acting. So is that the shift that we need to see to make resilience local?
Thank you so much, Danica. That's fantastic. So rethinking about resilience, also rethinking about development, because the development design is very much target focused. We are measured by number. Sometimes that number does not speak for the people. So that's a very good question. Anything else? Oliver, a little bit from you, Oliver. You have seen this process. I mean, you've been working in this humanitarian and disaster management and development for what, 40 years? It's like
unfortunately, yes. Huh? Unfortunately, yes.
Yes. So what does it mean when Oliver Lesion started working, some of us still went divers, still learning how to walk?
So I'm going to be very brief because we're coming next to the clock.
Okay.
Two observations from my side. I learned more in the last year about my craft than I did in the preceding 39 years. Because of the depth and the breadth of the discussions that we had 500 people engaged in this process, and some very, very powerful voices which were telling us, this is local, you guys need to catch up with what we're doing and what's happening. So that's the first thing. The second thing I would say is, it's an expression of appreciation to our colleagues in the ministry, Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade in Australia and BNPB for giving us the space to do what I think is a creative piece of work. I was particularly impressed by the ambassador's comments and her conclusion that we need to think about what we're doing here. It's really important to start thinking about how we reshape how disaster management works. Those would be my two key points.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, we got 3 minutes to go. I'll give a very quick response from you, listening to the what we call the audience, and from both of you, and then we'll hand over to Lucy to give a final remark. Please, she does very quick. You too.
I see it as a strengthening of our recommendations and process. And let's take the voice from our audience, from colleagues, from St. Transparency, from Jenica, and from Oliver. That's the point as a recommendation. We have to work together on taking up the recommendations and making it very concrete actions. I really like what Jenica said about the process of the target. And I think, I believe, some of us have been starting that kind of process in our
thank you so much. Yeah.
Sorry, thanks. I wanted to second the point that Oliver already mentioned. Also, a very excellent question from our colleagues over there. Do we need to rethink? Actually, it's a learning journey. So, as Oliver already mentioned, so learning, that means we can also improve and have the new things incorporated on what we are doing now. So, thanks, Oliver, for mentioning that. It has been a very, very meaningful learning journey for us. And like for today, I felt like all the recommendations in the report, resilience is local, have been showcased here. I heard our colleagues Adelina mentioned that she can speak English well. She still use Bahasa language as the local to communicate to those who are in the audience here. Our colleague Lucille, the lady, yeah, we used body language to communicate to us. So
inclusiveness, feminist principles, what else we already mentioned, girls' right approach, children and youth, you can see it's all here, it's also local. So let's carry on this approach, let's work together like this, and think centrally to improve the local results. And that would make us a success for the resilience building at the local level. Thank you.
Thank you so much, thank you. Big round of applause before we head over to Lucy. I'm not going to summarize. Do we get a bit of time? Lucy, over to you. Please close the session. Give us a thought and your remark.
This is what? Yes. Thank you so much, Pat Faisal. Thank you so much, Eduardo Center, and Mia, for your contributions to the Pat Plan, especially all of us, like, contributing over this process. For me, I think just in sort of summing up, the opportunity to learn from COVID, a global crisis affecting every single community pretty much, not in the same way, but at the same time, just seems too important to miss. We can't miss this opportunity to have those discussions, to have these stories, and to bring this situation to life, what communities are facing and how they're dealing with it. And that's not just in facing COVID-19, but that's also facing other disasters in the context of COVID-19 when traditional support systems had broken down and communities were in many places coming up with innovative solutions and responses on their own. So the second thing for me is that obviously resilience isn't a target, it's a non-negotiable. Communities are already responding. They're responding with or without us. They have agencies. They are the most invested in their response. It's the system that needs to catch up with communities and not the other way around. And to do that, we need to think about partnerships and relationships in a completely different way. And then I think thirdly, would be that, you know, this idea of resilience is not a static one. It's dynamic and it changes in every single situation. So whatever model that we adopt or models that we adopt, they constantly need to be in flux. Again, I think as everyone said today, none of this is new. We know this, but we do have a unique opportunity at this time to come together and learn from an experience that we're all having to different degrees and in different ways. But I'd also really like to thank you again, Pat Faisal, thank our panelists, but to thank everybody who's contributed to this journey. As has been mentioned, there were more than 500 organizations or 500 individuals that contributed through seminars, papers, number of different discussions and platforms. I really want to thank our team at Siaxiaga and Brian Oliver, done such a thorough and persistent job in putting this together and studying the learning. I'd also particularly like to thank our government of Australia and the governments of Indonesia for leading us through this process and engaging so actively. Thank you so much to everybody, and thank you to the audience as well for participating today.
Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our event. If you only can remember one thing, just remember, because resilient is local. Thank you so much. Have a good afternoon, everyone.